Hey girl, let's talk crime. I want to say thank you to Renisha Simone for requesting this next case. Mitrice Richardson was born on April 30th, 1985 to her parents, Latisse and Michael. They divorced when she was pretty young and her mother remarried and she was raised in California. She graduated high school and then she went on to attend California State University where she received her BA in psychology in 2008. So in the fall of 2009, things kind of started to go downhill for Mitrice. She and her girlfriend of 2 years had broken up and she had struggled with bipolar disorder and it seemed to no longer be under control. So around this time, she was also living with her great-grandmother Mildred in South LA. And on Wednesday, September the 16th, 2009, she takes this spontaneous road trip from South LA to Malibu. This little road trip is about a 40-mile drive, and she ends up getting there around dinner time and pulls into this high-end restaurant called Jeffrey's. When she pulled in, the valet said that immediately he felt like something was off. She was talking about avenging the death of Michael Jackson, and he thought maybe she was just kind of being like weirdly cool and just didn't really think much of it. He did find her in his car, which he had left open when he went to go park hers, and just kind of asked her to get out of it. And that's when she goes into the restaurant. So once inside, she ends up ordering a steak and a cocktail. And she's making more bizarre comments like, I'm from Mars, but people around her didn't feel threatened by it. So they just kind of went along with it. Her bill comes up to $89, but she was unable to pay. Now, I'm not sure why she was unable to pay or if she refused to pay because she did leave her purse in the car, but the restaurant was trying to be accommodating and they asked if there was anyone that could pay. The only number that she remembered offhand was her great-grandmother's in which she called, and her great-grandmother Mildred offered to pay, but they wouldn't allow her to unless she faxed in her signature, which she did not have access to a fax machine. So the manager of Jeffrey's ends up calling the police because he felt like because he was worried about her, she would be better in custody and would be able to get back to her family as opposed to leaving the restaurant and kind of not knowing what would happen. So the police end up coming around 9 p.m. and they think that she's drunk or under the influence of drugs. So they do give her a breathalyzer, which she passes. They end up arresting her for not paying her bill, and also they did find less than an ounce of marijuana in her car. So they impound her car that has her purse, her jacket, her phone, everything in it, and they take her to the Los Hills Sheriff Station. So Mitrice was booked around 11 p.m., and according to the logbook, she made 4 phone calls, and she told deputies that she had called her great-grandmother, and apparently the calls were not recording because the recording equipment was faulty at that time. However, the phone company showed no records of the calls, and Mildred, her great-grandmother, was adamant that she did not receive any calls from her great-granddaughter. So her mother ends up finding out what's going on. She calls the police station and says, hey, are you guys going to release her or what are you going to do? And they said, well, we could, but, you know, we'll just keep her until 6 a.m. when we release everyone. And she said, okay, because I could come now, but if you're going to keep her, that's great. You know, I could just come in the morning, but please don't release her on her own. You know, she's been struggling a little bit mentally, and I want to make sure that I'm there for her safely in the morning. She then jokingly says to the detective, I would hate to wake up in the morning to a report, girl lost somewhere and her head chopped off. So she is completely satisfied. This is around 12:30 a.m. and not even 5 minutes after they hang up, Mitrice is released. Now they said that that she could sleep in the lobby until her mom came in the morning, but that she was free to go, and that's exactly what she did. So Lost Hills Station is in the middle of nowhere. And this is in the middle of the night. She has no clue where she's at. She doesn't have her phone. She doesn't have her purse. She doesn't have anything. And she begins walking in the direction in which she came. And I read an article that said, according to Google, it would take 6 hours to walk the 16 miles through the mountains to get back to Malibu. So the following morning comes and Latisse calls the station to kind of prepare to come get her daughter. And that's when she was informed that she had actually been released
hours prior. And of course, she was upset because that was not what they had told her. And she was trying to figure out how she could file a missing persons report. And they told her that she needed to wait 24 hours. So now the search was on for Mitrice, and there was a man named Bill Smith who had called police to report that he had seen a woman in his backyard around 6:30 in the morning, and he asked her if she was okay. She said she was just resting, but by the time he got ready and dressed to go out there, she was already gone. On August 9th, 2010, almost a year after Mitrice had vanished, about 8 miles from the sheriff's department, a human skull was found. So they notified the family and said that they would go back in the morning to inspect the site because it was too dark that evening. However, the sheriff's department gathered up her remains that night, put them in a plastic bag, and flew back to the station. The sheriff's department believed that this was an accident and they do not consider it a homicide. The coroner determined her death to be undetermined.